guys, it's me again, and today we are studying about balanced occlusion. So what is a balanced occlusion? It consists of two terminologies, balance and occlusion. So what is balance? Balance is when force is exerted on any structure, but that force doesn't result in any movement or motion. The structure is known to be in balance. And what is an occlusion? When the mandible and the maxillary teeth contact, they are termed to be as an occlusion. So in layman terms, we can define balanced occlusion as a bilateral simultaneous, which occurs on both left and the right side, anterior and posterior occlusal contact in centric and eccentric positions. So basically it's a bilateral simultaneous contact, both occurring on the left and the right side in the anterior and the posterior occlusal direction, in the centric as well as eccentric positions. So why do we need to study about the balanced occlusion? We need to put the teeth in such a place, in such an area that they are in balance. So it does not occur, it doesn't compromise the stability of the teeth or the denture. It also preserves the ridges. And lastly, there is no cuspal interference during mastication. So when the teeth are placed in a balanced occlusion, these three things are obtained in a denture. There is proper stability, increased stability and retention. There is preservation of ridges by distribution of occlusal roads in a proper way. And there is no cuspal interference because the teeth are in balanced occlusion. So what are the factors which affect the balanced occlusion? There are basically five factors which affect balanced occlusion. First of them is the condylar guidance. So what is the condylar guidance? The path travelled by the condyle in the glenoid fossa is the condylar guidance. The more the path is travelled by the condyle, the more is the amount of jaw separation. So from the condylar guidance, we can say that increase in the condylar guidance is directly proportional to increase in the jaw separation. Next we have is the incisal guidance. So what is an incisal guidance? Incisal guidance is nothing but the influence of the contact between the mandible and the maxillary anterior teeth on the mandibular movements of the jaws. Okay? So what is the significance? So when the horizontal overlap is increased, there is a decrease in the angle of inclination. Next we have is the plane of occlusion. So plane of occlusion is nothing but an imaginary surface which lies and contacts the incisal edges of the anterior teeth and the cusp tips of the posterior teeth. It is just a theoretical concept, but it represents the mean surface, the mean curvature of any surface. Alright, next we have the compensating curves. So compensating curves are basically divided into two parts, anterior-posterior compensating curve and medial-lateral compensating curve. Under the anterior-posterior compensating curve, we have got the curve of spee. So what is a curve of spee? First we'll see that curve of spee is nothing but if we assume this to be a mandible, the line drawn from the cusp tips of a canine touching the buccal cusp tips of the premolar and molar, this curve which is protruded posteriorly to the anteriormost point of the condyle, this curve is known as the curve of spee. So what is the significance of the curve of spee? So when the teeth are placed in this curve, the mandible protrudes and the teeth remains in contact. The teeth will glide without any interferences when the teeth are placed in such a occlusion. In the mesiolingual, we have curve of Wilson and curve of Monsoon. So curve of Wilson is nothing but when a line is drawn from the surfaces of the molars, that is the buccal and the lingual cusps of the molar. It results in a curvature structure. This is known as curve of Wilson. So curve of Wilson, the significance of this curve of Wilson is nothing but it helps in the lateral balance of the occlusion. And last but not the least, we have got the curve of monsoon. Curve of monsoon is a combination of curve of Spee and curve of Wilson. This can be viewed in the coronal and the sagittal planes, and the curve of monsoon will be concave in the mandibular arch and it will be convex in the maxillary arch. Last but not the least, we have got the cuspal inclination. So cuspal inclination is nothing but, if we seem this to be a molar, okay, alright, this is a molar and these are the cusp tips and this is the surface of the cuspal plane, this is the cuspal angle. The angle formed by the cuspal plane and the cusp tip is known as the cuspal inclination. So why did we study the five factors affecting the balanced occlusion? Because if we want our dentures to be balanced, we need to keep these things in mind. On one side there is condylar guidance and the incisal guidance. This should be in harmony with the plane of occlusion, the compensating curves and the cuspal inclination. Only when all these five factors balances out each other, we can get a balanced occlusion. Now we come to the types of balanced occlusion. There are basically four types of balanced occlusions: unilateral, bilateral, protrusive and lateral. So unilateral balanced occlusion is when the teeth contacts just on the one side. So there is an occlusal contact on one side of the, either on the left or the right side. So one contact. Or on one side. This is basically seen in FPDs, that is fixed partial dentures. Then we have the bilateral, when the contact between the teeth occurs on both the sides, and bilateral contacts are necessary because it distributes the forces evenly and it also improves the stability of the dentures. Then we have the protrusion. So when the protrusive occlusion is nothing but when the mandible moves in a forward direction, there is a 3-point contact which occurs. 2 points are placed posteriorly and 1 point is anteriorly placed. So the teeth need to have this 2-point and 1 point, that is a total of 3-point contacts in our dentures to maintain the balance of our dentures. The next is the lateral occlusion. It is divided into canine guided and group lateral. So this is just an overview about the types of balanced occlusion. Now we come to the mechanics of balanced occlusion. There is a phenomena known as Christensen's phenomena. So Christensen's phenomena says that in natural dentition, when the mandible moves forward, there is a gap between the posterior upper and the lower teeth. Alright. So if this is the maxilla and this is the mandible, when the mandible moves forward, there will be a gap between the maxillary and the mandibular teeth. But this gap is not good for us in the dentures. So in dentures, if we allow that movement, just that 1 point contact in the anterior region, it will lead to the tipping movement. And the tipping movement is not good for the stability of our dentures. So in the mandibular teeth, in dentition, we need to have proper contact anteriorly and posteriorly. So this is basically in natural dentition, we can say when the mandible moves forward, it creates a gap between the upper and the lower arches or the teeth. But in the dentition or the dentures, when the mandible moves forward, it will contact the anterior incisal edges, which will cause tipping right? So these are just some few topics which I touched from this chapter, that is balanced occlusion. You can also check in your textbooks about the concepts of balanced occlusion and the theories. Thanks for watching.